When I walked in the building this morning, the forestall, I came in at the basement floor, and I passed by the Energy Information Administration, and I saw a sign saying that we help people understand energy. Today, I'm going to try to assist you in better understanding security and the security umbrella and protocols that we have within security. I titled my talk, Unrivaled Energy Security, for a specific reason. When I think about unrivaled, I have to think about the definition of the term. It's incomparable. It's unparalleled. It's unsurpassed. And when you think about it in those terms, you have to reflect in comparison to what? On August the 4th, 1977, the Department of Energy stood up. It was created. And since that time, security has kind of struggled. Security is often misunderstood, and when oftentimes it's viewed as an afterthought. And when you don't think about security up front, it can create problems for you later on down the line. Before I get into all of my talk, I kind of want to give a little bit of background about where I sit, and we'll go on. I'm not sure if you can see the screen, but here I am, and these are the whole, I got an all-star team of professionals that deal with all aspects, the full spectrum of security, from classified management to working security protocols, as far as trying to distinguish and develop protection strategies for special nuclear material, to actually the pro force and actually guard us and protect us every single day. So that's a huge, absolutely huge responsibility. And to think that DOE would trust me to lead that effort, a bit comical, but nonetheless, I think that by reading the background, you can see that I have over 30 years worth of experience, and now's the time to actually put that to work. But let's go on. Let me kind of provide the background of how I came up with this thing, Unrivaled Energy Security. My good friend and colleague and self-appointed mentor, Dr. Jim McGee, works in AU 1.1. Last year, he wrote a paper dealing with cognitive dissonance. And cognitive dissonance is the mental stress or discomfort experienced by a person who simultaneously holds two or more contradictory beliefs, ideas, and values. And so when a person is asked to do something, let's say, for instance, respond to an incident, when internally they're saying there's something wrong. Dr. McGee calls us to kind of better think about how are we actually preparing for readiness? What are those protocols that we're actually putting in place? And it's through his efforts and his continual efforts that he started me to start thinking a little bit deeper about security and how we're actually delivering security. Dr. McGee came up with, there's a sudden confrontation with the unbelievable. If I'm a guard on a gate and someone are, if I'm standing at the threshold of this facility and someone piggybacks behind someone, then they didn't follow the normal protocols. And that kind of causes a reaction inside of me standing guard there to now go into action and rely upon my training. That split second between my thinking and my action can cause a disconnect. So how well prepared are we? How are we actually thinking within the department about all of security, the full spectrum of security? That's my responsibility to climb up on the perch or on the balcony and to look down and to evaluate everything that we're actually doing. Very, very critical responsibility. In 1989, Admiral James Watkins actually did a study. And he said, DOE, you got some problems. You got some problems. There are some things that perhaps need to be fixed a little bit better. That was followed by another study by Admiral Childs and Admiral Meese. And the theme continued on that there are some disconnects between our security policy and the way that we're actually performing. What we actually found and still continue to see, as borne out by enterprise assessment, is that oftentimes we create silos of excellence or stovepipes at both the site as well as within headquarters that work against ourselves. And when you have that, it creates some anxieties, some confusion, some chaos. And it's that chaos that needs to be addressed. In 2012, July of 2012, the Y-12 incident occurred. And that created a sea change of anxieties within the security across the board. My good friend, General Sandy Fennin, came in and did another report. And she started looking at the way that we were actually organized. And what she concluded is that there's some resistance to the way that we're organized that will cause some problems. And so again, security was being examined at the lowest levels and even at the highest levels that kind of caused us to kind of relook some things. So what's the cost? What's the cost if we don't change? The cost is that we will continue to spend billions of dollars on security. Potentially, we may have some assets that are vulnerable. Our workforce may go unprotected. The point of my presentation is that we cannot stay at the level that we are, that we have to make some change. So how do we make those necessary changes within security? Well, I like to call it, again, unrivaled energy security. And so from this perspective, with that backdrop, now you can kind of follow my logic and what I'm thinking. What I'm saying is that some things must change. And if it sounds like I'm getting a little bit excited, it's because I'm very passionate about this topic. I'm not sure about you, but I have three daughters. Three daughters that I care dearly about. And every time that they brought a suitor home, being the cop that I am, I gave them the nth degree. Not only did I give them the nth degree, I did a background check on them, their parents, their cousins, their great-grandparents. I wanted to know, who is this young man coming into my house? And what do you want to do with my daughter? That same veracity, that same energy, that same passion that I have for my daughters need to be applied in this space. Why? Because we're talking about not only protecting the people that work here, but we're talking about protecting the generations of energy protocols that go on inside this facility and this department. Folks, security is bigger than just us. Security is bigger than just me. Security will provide and sustain us a future for my grandkids and great-grandchildren, as well as yours. That's the reason why we need unrivaled energy security. I like to use the C word, and that's collaboration. Security is an all teams on deck. It's a team sport. It's a team endeavor. We cannot develop policy, security policy, in silos. Not only is it dumb, you must share. You got to share the wealth. Because there's some aspects of security that we just don't know. Those stovepipes of excellence that we so long for, that we create out of desperation and survival, they have to come tumbling down. As long as I'm here, I'm going to use that same fighting protocol that I would use inside the ring and trying to knock down those protocols. Well, some of you may smile at that, but again, the same passion that I took to fight. And you see, when you get inside the ring, it doesn't make a difference how well you prepare. It doesn't make a difference about your situation or your circumstances. It's about, can you produce? Are you going to do what you need to do? Well, folks, the point that I make here is that security is the exact same way. We need an unrivaled approach, an unmatched approach, an approach that will take us so far forward into the future. I want us to be able to start painting outside of the canvas to be able to understand how are we protecting people. What are we what's the legacy that we are actually leaving? And so again, collaboration is necessary. It is essential. Secondly, you see unparalleled expertise. Whatever got us here won't take us till tomorrow. We have to continue to develop our minds. We must become lifelong learners. We have to dig in and say, what I did yesterday is not enough to carry me forward. And we're going to talk a little bit more about the STEM and the sciences and things of that nature, of how that needs to be incorporated, because surprisingly, it hasn't always been the case within security. And then, of course, lastly, an enterprise security risk management approach. What are we willing to what is it that we can't protect? How are we packaging those security protocols as we send them to the seventh floor? Critical, absolutely critical, especially when we're trying to match protection strategies to existing technologies. And so how we package that and how we understand that, how we interpret that from a collaborative perspective will depend and will determine of where we're going. Well, what are some of those tools? As I look into my crystal ball with security, there's a variety of things that need to be addressed. User behavior analytics, cyber risk, as we're evaluating the asymmetric threat, as it deals with physical security protocols, data loss prevention, mobile security, using actually and leveraging more sophisticated analytics. Big data is something that we always talk about, but yet and still we don't necessarily know how to protect. Now it may sound like I'm speaking as if I'm the CIO or I come from that department. The point that I make here is that physical security and digital or cybersecurity are beginning to merge. How you access even your area or this facility is now cyber control. It's no longer analog. We have to develop our thinking as we move forward. There needs to be more comprehensive security solutions. As we start thinking about radar, we must use quantum radar and start taking, instead of baby steps, quantum leaps on actually how we go about acquiring these new systems. In my conclusion, unrivaled energy security is the concept at this stage. My job is now to translate that concept into action, into meaningful policy that will move the department forward. Can't do it by myself. I need a lot of work. Why? Because you matter. You matter. The next generation matters. And the only way to get what I'm trying to describe is by working together. Unrivaled energy security means reading and seeking new knowledge, aligning ourselves with new partners, with people that necessarily don't look like us or think like us. It means reaching out into communities that may have other interests, as well as other stakeholders that perhaps we can partnership. We need to develop a sustained, high-performing, high-tempo operating system, and the only way to do that is by working together. I sincerely appreciate you and thank you for your time.